Good afternoon. I think I know most of the people in the room, but I'm Albert Park. I'm the director of the Institute for Emerging Market Studies, and today we have another one of our academic seminars, and we're very happy to welcome Piotr Lewandowski, who is a labor economist and the president of the board of the Institute for Structural Research in Warsaw, Poland, and he's also a research fellow at IZA, the Institute for the Study of Labor in Bonn. He has collaborated in the past with the Warsaw School of Economics and the Ministry of Labor and Social Policy in Poland, and his research interests include minimum wage issues, temporary contracts and labor market segmentation, the influence of technology on jobs, pensions and social policy, transition economics, and labor market effects of climate and energy policies. So quite broad within the field of labor. And Piotr's institute and our institute have been collaborating regularly over the past several years. So he's now, I think, an old friend of ours. And so we're very happy to have him here.
Thank you, Albert. Thanks for introduction and for invitation. And thanks, everyone, for coming to this seminar. As Albert said, we've been collaborating for the last 3 years within the Networks for Jobs and Development, which Institute for Emerging Market Studies is like Asian partner, and our institute is a European partner. And the talk that I will give today will present the research that we've been working at IBS for almost 2 years now with a colleague of mine, Wojciech Hardy, who is here with me. He's here with me because we are now collaborating with Albert and colleagues here on tasks and task content of jobs and the interplay between the technology, education, and the what people actually do in the labor market. I'm going to talk about these issues related to technology, education, structural changes, and the content of jobs in Central and Eastern Europe. The main focus is on tasks. So before I actually go into the findings, let's just define what tasks are, because that's let's just define what tasks are. It feels kind of intuitive that task, that's something that we all do on a daily basis, but in the labor economics literature, tasks are defined as something that is a unit of work that we need to perform to create something. So we can think about tasks as components of jobs. At the same time, tasks are not skills, because tasks are more as a characteristics of work, of a job, occupation, whereas skills is something that people have, that they possess and they use. So a particular task might require several skills to perform, and also several particular skills can be utilized to perform various tasks. So there is a relationship between task and skills, because very complex tasks require advanced skills, but they are not the same. People often confuse, which I don't really like. For example, if you read the recent World Development Report, I think they do confuse. They talk about tasks, but they call them skills. So let's keep them separate. It is important because particular tasks are, to keep them separate, because particular tasks are most common in different occupations. On this table here, I'm distinguishing between five types of tasks, which are the most typically used in the literature and that I will use in this talk. And just give you some examples. What are the occupations that are characterized by this task to a largest extent? So we will distinguish five types of tasks. Two of them are clustered as non-routine cognitive, and they could be analytical or personal. When we use the non-routine cognitive, that cognitive is very intuitive. It's something that we perform using basically brains, or mainly brains. What does it mean, non-routine? Here, non-routine means that these are tasks that cannot be really structured completely and cannot be and are not performed on a repetitive basis. They require adaptability, they require creativity, they require problem solving, they also require human-to-human interactions. So that's not something that you can replace by algorithm or write an algorithm to replace completely, at least now, at least for now. And the examples of these kind of occupations or jobs that use these tasks to a larger extent, it's like managers, IT specialists, architects, engineers, researchers as well. There are also routine cognitive tasks. So routine cognitive tasks, again, perform largely with brains, but are largely repetitive or can be structured. Basically, the qualities that you expect is to be exact, be accurate, be able to do something in a regular manner, repetitive manner, deliver the same quality all time. So examples, bookkeepers, tellers, office clerks, salespersons, researchers to some extent as well, because when we are checking for missing data, that's basically routine cognitive. And manual also can be divided into routine and non-routine, because some of the manual jobs are very routine, to a larger extent manufacturing jobs. At the same time, other like assemblers, tool makers, that's a routine manual job. But there are also non-routine manual jobs, like driving. It's non-routine because you have to react to what's happening around you. Also, farmers, not really routine because conditions may change, so you have to react. Waitress is another example of the manual but non-routine occupation because you have to interact with people and react to what these people expect. So that's more or less this. And you can just, when you look at this classification, you can see that the tasks are not skills, because the skills that manager needs and the skill that the architect needs are very, very different. But they both perform tasks which can be classified into these broader categories. So where does all this typology comes from? Just now, like a very brief discussion of the literature, it all started with author Levi Marnay in 2003 paper, who looked at the evolution of the US labor market from these angles, and they look at occupations and use the ONET data to create this this typology. What was the motivation for their work and behind looking in these categories? The three stylized facts about American labor market and to some extent about every other developed OECD labor market. The first one is the rising wage premium for graduates, largely since like 70s. You could see that there were like rising wage premiums for graduates and increasing wage gap between graduates and non-graduates. That also meant increasing wage inequality. We've all heard about wage inequality in the US for the last year all the time, so no need to have more introduction. And at the same time, the third stylized fact was the hollowing out of the middle-skilled employment. So like the middle class, the simple office jobs and the manufacturing jobs, they tend to be declining. So if they combine these three, they arrive into something that they call job polarization. So like the increasing number of high-skilled, well-paid jobs, the increasing number of MAC jobs or low-skilled jobs, or low-paid jobs, and flat employment in the middle-skilled of the distribution. At the same time, what was happening on the technology side was, on the one hand, the falling price of ICT. The computers are getting more powerful and more cheaper. The phones are getting more powerful, more cheaper. The technology is more prevalent and permeats the economy and becomes like a general use technology. And that created the deruthanization hypothesis. So the hypothesis says that the way the digital technologies evolved was based on algorithms. Algorithms are useful to create machines, various machines, which perform things which are being repeated, which are structured, so that technology should wipe out the routine or replace people in performing routine tasks. So that's the framework here. And if you look at studies, most of the papers are actually written on the US or for other developed countries, And if you look at the papers on the US, you see that, well, empirical research confirms that deruthenization hypothesis. This is a graph from Otto Price 2013 paper, which kind of updates the 2003 paper. And as you can see, what was happening in the US, let's just have a look at the routine manual and routine cognitive jobs. So until like late 1960s, they were increasing, but then they started declining. So in the American economy, that's happening for over 40 years, that the routine cognitive and routine manual jobs, which are, let's say, middle-skilled services jobs and middle-skilled office jobs and middle-skilled manufacturing jobs, they've been declining. The non-routine manual jobs were also declining, or tasks in the US were also declining for a long time, but they kind of rebounded in the late 90s. And on the other hand, the non-routine analytical and the non-routine interpersonal tasks, they were flat in the 60s, but they started rising in late 60s and kept increasing. So the empirical research for the US, they find this deroutinization hypothesis, and they attribute most of these changes to the technology progress and to digital technology replacing people in performing the routine cognitive and routine manual task. They also say the literature also thinks that the rebound of non-routine manual is related to the fact that the computers are not really able to replace waitresses yet or drivers yet, but the fact that there is widening, like wage inequality, creates like still increasing demand for simple jobs like personal services for many people, usually in cities. However, the research on emerging economies, middle-skilled economies, is scarce. So it's basically non-existent. So what we've been trying to do in the paper that some of you grabbed and that I'll be presenting here is try to bridge this gap and create and check if similar developments are happening in the middle-income economies. And we focus on a group of countries, on 10 countries. In Central and Eastern Europe, all these countries share a couple of macroeconomic or institutional developments. They were communist countries in second part of the 20th century, then abandoned communists in 1989 or 1990, depending on the country, then started converging with the Western European countries. But still, if you look at what's the technology penetration in these countries, you could see that the gap vis-a-vis the US is still large, because the ICT stock levels per worker, even in 2011, in countries like Romania, which is the poorest in the sample, were like 3% of ICT capital stock per worker. In the US, Czech Republic, Slovakia, Poland, better, but still it's like 20-25%. Of the American level, which is much larger gap than the gap in GDP per capita, which, because the GDP per capita relationship would be like 60. So a couple of stylized facts on this, on the group of countries, which you might not be very well familiar with. So
yeah, that's literally computers per capita, and it's the ICT.
No, it's ICT, it's not
It's the value of
ICT various, like computers and software and other tools, let's say, like mobile phones. So it's computers, software, but also investment. So not really the value of computers owned by households, but that value that could be attributed to firms and companies. These are the data that were created for the WDR 2016, like a background paper, and I was able to get this data. So that's like a capital stock, and then calculated in per worker terms. So the stylized fact about the region is that there has been macroeconomic convergence over the last 25 years, pretty fast, I would say. So all these countries were about like now are at the level of like 75% of the average GDP per capita in the European Union. All these countries have joined the European Union in 2004 or 2007 or 2010, depending on the progress. Most of these countries have joined OECD, like Poland, Czech, Slovakia, Estonia, they joined the OECD. Latvia, Lithuania, not yet. There are also substantial structural shifts. These countries were largely dependent on agriculture in late 80s or early 90s. The agriculture has declined substantially as the GDP and employment share, but still accounts for a much higher share of total employment than it's typical for the OECD countries. For example, in Poland, agriculture accounts for like 12% of employment these days, which is much higher than Germany, France, where employment in agriculture is like 2%. What is important?
Yes.
What is also important is the manufacturing. The communist states were highly industrialized. So the manufacturing share in Poland, Czech Republic, Hungary was like 25% in late 80s. And after the transition shock, it declined a little bit because many industries just collapsed, but it declined to like 20%. So if you look at the entire European Union, actually only Germany and Italy are more industrialized than Poland, Czech, Slovakia, or Hungary these days. So manufacturing declined, but it's still larger than in the UK or France. And services have been growing over the same period. On the labor supply development, the most crucial one was a huge educational boom. So there was a large increase in the average years of schooling and a large shift from vocational education to tertiary education over the last 25 years. So for example, the enrollment rate in tertiary education in Poland used to be like 15% in the early 90s, and now it's almost 50% enrollment in tertiary education. So there is a huge inflow of graduates on the labor market every year, and the educational structure of the labor force is changing substantially because of that. Okay, let's move to tasks. So how do we measure the task content of jobs? We use the EU LFS data for all these countries, so that's kind of like a synchronized, harmonized the LFS for all the countries in the European Union. We studied the 1998-2013 period, and we used the three-digit ISCO occupation codes. ISCO is like the European classification of occupations. It's harmonized between all countries. Three-digit means that for each country we have like about 100 occupations. And we're going to assign the task measures for the occupations. So to get the information on task, we use the ONET data. ONET is the American database which collects information of what are the requirements of occupations. And the number of occupations covered is huge. It's like hundreds of them. So the information on occupational requirements are kind of scarce. So people in Europe have to use the American ones because there are no other surveys. But it works quite well. There were some studies in Italy, in Czech Republic, and the UK, which show that you can really adjust. And the outcomes are quite similar if you use country-specific studies. But rarely we have such detailed information. So we use the ONET data, which is this data set on task items. So for example, information, how important it is to be exact and accurate in a particular occupation, how important it is to be to repeat the same thing, or how important it is to solve problems, to be creative, to have manual dexterity and things like that. And we use two editions of ONET, 2003 and 14, so we can also account for how the requirements change within occupation, how much the occupation has changed over the last 15 years. For example, this data shows that the occupation of pilots have become much more routine than it used to be, which makes sense. And then we use these task items, about 30 of them, manual dexterity, problem solving, and so on, to create five annual country-level task content measures. So then we work only with these five: non-routine, cognitive, analytical, non-routine, cognitive, interpersonal, routine, cognitive, routine, manual, non-routine, manual. Okay, the first finding. The first finding is that if you look at this group of countries, it's a very familiar story to what was happening in the US or in the UK. You could see that the non-routine, cognitive, analytical, and interpersonal were growing, analytical faster than personal, but both were growing. You could also see that the manual jobs are declining, the routine manual jobs are declining, the non-routine manual tasks are declining over the entire period. But there is a caveat. Something is different. What is different is that the routine cognitive is increasing. So it's very different from the graph for the US that I presented earlier that had a decline in routine cognitive. They're increasing in the region on the average. So that's one puzzle, let's say, or one thing that we would like to explain. If we look at changes from between 1998 and 2013, for each country, we'll see that this growth in non-routine cognitive tasks was actually happening in all the countries. It was strongest in Slovenia or Estonia, in Lithuania. Was not that impressive in Slovakia, but they were growing everywhere. The manual were declining everywhere. To a large extent, countries like Slovenia and again Lithuania, not so much in Czech Republic, not so much in Slovakia, but they were declining everywhere. The routine cognitive, which overall were rising, and that's kind of a puzzle, were also a bit more diversified between countries. So there are countries where routine cognitive grew substantially, like Romania, Lithuania, Latvia, Poland. They barely changed in Czech Republic. They barely grew in Estonia, and they declined in Slovenia. So there is heterogeneity between countries in that regard. So another puzzle we would like to answer. So when we have the stylized facts of the overall this evolution, we would like to ask what were the factors in play? What were the factors behind this kind of these changes? And we will use two types of exercise. We will use a regression, a panel regression, and we will use some shift shred decomposition. Let me start with the regression. The question we would like to ask with the regression is that what was the relative importance of the labor supply factors like education and upskilling of the workforce, and what was the importance of labor demand factors like technology, and which is which people in the literature basically attribute most of the changes to. So we don't really have the information on technology on all the countries. So we're gonna proxy technology with R&D spending in particular countries, which is also being done in the literature quite often. And on this slide here, we just ran a regression for the countries where we have data on ICT and R&D spending, just to show that there is a strong positive correlation between ICT stock and R&D spending. So we're gonna use R&D in the larger sample of countries for those where we have no data on ICT. And knowing that, we're just running a stylized simple regression, no claim of causality here. We just wanna identify which factors are, let's say, more important. And we're running a panel regression where we try to explain a changes of particular tasks, non-routine cognitive, analytical, personal, routine cognitive, and so on, with three factors. First, the share of persons with tertiary education in the labor force, the share of persons with secondary education attained, and R&D spending per GDP. So we're controlling for the structure of labor force and technology. So what we find is that for non-routine cognitive, analytical, and personal, basically the education is highly significant. And if you replace one worker with primary education, or one percentage point of the labor force with primary education, with one percentage point of labor force with tertiary education attained, that increases the share, that increases the the non-routine cognitive analytical tasks by 1.5, right? If you replace 1% percentage point of labor force with primary education, with 1 percentage point with secondary education, that increases the non-routine analytical by 0.7. So we find that there is a positive correlation between the share of tertiary educated and the non-routine cognitive task, the negative between the manual task and the share of people of tertiary education attained. With secondary education, we see that if there were shifts between primary and secondary, that doesn't really matter for, that didn't really matter for personal, didn't really matter for manual, a little bit for analytical. We also find that there is a correlation, positive one, between the R&D spending proxies for technology and routine and non-routine cognitive tasks, but it's not very significant, not very strong finding. There's not much happening with manual, so we think that it's rather about labor force structure in terms of education than narrowly R&D. But what is also striking here is that for routine cognitive, we can't really explain anything here, right? With the regression. So to explain the routine cognitive and to show what's happening, what were the factors behind routine cognitive, we're gonna move to the Schittre decomposition. So the Schittre decomposition will in the Schittre decomposition we're distinguishing between the contribution of structural change. T is task, H is the share in the labor force of people in sector J with education I. So share with people with sector J with education K in time period I. Okay, let me put it this way. So we're distinguishing between the contribution of structural change. So tasks, if tasks haven't changed, if task contents of in particular sector education change haven't changed since the late 90s, but only the structure of the economy changed, then we have the contribution of educational change. So what would be the change in tasks if educational structure has changed, but there was no structural change in terms of sectors of the economy, and there was no change in the task contents within the narrow education sectoral brackets. Then we also disentangle the occupational change. So what would be the change in task if sectoral structure remained constant and educational structure remained constant, but the changes within the occupational, within sectoral educational cells occurred as we observed them in the data, and there is also this interaction term. So we distinguish between these three. And when we decompose the routine cognitive tasks, and we rank countries by the overall change in routine cognitive from those that have like the decline to those which had like the strongest increase, we find that the main important factor for routine cognitive task grow was the structural change. So we find that the routine tasks were rising because of the sectoral shifts of labor force from one sector to another sector. And you could see that the countries where the routine cognitive grew most, that structural effect was very powerful. Here, Romania, Poland as well, Croatia to some extent. In Latvia, there was also occupational change, but the structural change is the most powerful one. So let's now look at this decomposition differently, and let's calculate the sum of all effects, the sum of the structural change, the sum of the occupational change, and of the educational change. But let's just calculate this effect by sector and look what were the sectors that actually contributed most to these changes. So that's what I'm doing on this graph here. We're calculating the sum of the effects by sector. So we're focusing on the contribution of sectors. And we find that the agriculture was the sector that that contributed most to the growth of routine cognitive tasks. How to understand that? I mean, agriculture, these are highly manual physical jobs. There's barely any cognitive content in agricultural jobs. So if agriculture has been declining and people were moving from agriculture to other sectors or not entering agriculture, if you think, for example, if you think of children of farmers, so if people were moving from rural areas to cities and leaving agriculture to take any other job in the cities, the cognitive content of the average cognitive content of jobs in countries were increasing because every services jobs is more cognitive than the agricultural jobs. And at the same time, it was important for routine cognitive jobs because these people were not taking jobs that were problem solving, creativity. These were other routine cognitive jobs like services, manufacturing jobs, middle skilled. So we find that the contribution of agriculture to the overall growth of it was positive everywhere, but the countries with the strongest growth of routine cognitive had a substantial contribution of agriculture, of like declining agriculture, to the growth of routine cognitive tasks. The second sector that contributed positively was transport, storage, communication, finance, and real estate. That's the clustering of like services sector. So that shows that the reallocation out of agriculture was largely absorbed by services. So these sectors which were absorbing are highly routine cognitive. So the fact that they were rising was pushing up the routine cognitive tasks in the entire region. What was the sector that was like slowing down this process? Manufacturing. So manufacturing was slightly declining. So the decline of manufacturing and also the changes of occupational structures within manufacturing were compressing the routine cognitive tasks. So we can think about it that if there was no decline if there was no change within manufacturing and no shrinking of manufacturing, the overall increase in routine cognitive tasks would be even higher, right? If we apply this same decompositions to other tasks like non-routine analytical tasks, we could see that for non-routine analytical, I have a slight error here. This should be structural change and the not educational twice, of course. So the importance of structural change for non-routine was actually much lower than the contribution of educational change. So educational change contributed more to the growth of non-routine than purely the structural change. So you can think that if that region has only experienced sectoral shifts without huge increase in the number of graduates, the increase in non-routine cognitive tasks would be much lower than actually observed. And then on the other hand, if we look at manual and we try to decompose the decline in manual tasks, it's kind of similar to what we've seen on the previous slide. Here, the structural change was compressing the manual tasks. The educational effect the same because people were attending were longer, the average year of schooling increased and people were moving into largely to tertiary education and general secondary rather than vocational. So these were factors that were decreasing the manual tasks. What is interesting here that the occupational change was increasing the manual tasks. So there was some kind of downgrading within sectors that increased the manual tasks. Okay, to sum up, the growth of non-routine cognitive tasks and the decline of manual tasks is like a secular feature of the entire region. The increase in routine cognitive tasks is something that distinguishes the region from Western European countries or the US. We can largely attribute these changes to workforce upskilling, and structural change was the very potent factor behind the increase in routine cognitive. So if the routine cognitive, yes.
Is this associated with trade at all? Does I mean, is this offshoring of routine cognitive tasks by Western European economies toward the East, or is it?
I would say that to some extent, yes. To some extent, I think it's this meaning of structural change is driven by the internal factors, like the, if you let's say that the number of invoices being issued every week in these countries these days is much higher than 20 years ago, and it's still largely a process which is largely performed by humans, assisted by computers, and not really automatized. But there was clearly increasing importance of business process outsourcing being located in the region, and that was largely in the cognitive part of the process. So shared services in accounting, call centers, and things like that. Unfortunately, we can't really test that empirically here, because the LFS data doesn't really provide such a detailed information about whether people work in the foreign-owned or outsourcing or offshoring companies. Because there is information about ownership sector, but if these companies are exporting the services or whatever, we just have no clue. So we can speculate at the sector level, but we can't test directly. But the intuition is that it was important.
Yeah, but you could do it at the country level, of course, characterize some of these.
Yes, we can look at the trading services and try to see at the trading services flows. Yes. Yes.
Sorry, why just services though? Why can't we trade in goods?
Because when we talk about routine cognitive, we think that it's rather trading services. If we think about offshoring, then the offshoring of services here would be important, not really of manufacturing, if we talk about routine cognitive. We can look at both, but the trading services, I think, is
it's crucial.
Sorry, you don't have the data at the so it's all at a one-digit sector level.
No, it's all at what we do here is all at three-digit occupational.
So you could tell at the sectoral level for each country how exposed they are to trade.
Yes.
So I mean it wouldn't be definitive that you can identify some cognitive or not a routine as being specifically offshoring, but you could, correlate.
Yes, that's what we could do. That's true.
Yes. I have another question.
We could do at the sectoral with offshoring or how sectors are exposed to trade. We don't have technology data at the sectoral level. So we can't really, so that's one caveat, that it could be technology in place.
That's unlikely to vary within a country.
So, I mean, I think that the next two slides will kind of shed more light on the question you ask, actually. So if there is routine cognitive rising, so there is the question, who are these people who are performing these routine cognitive jobs? And and that's something we want to answer now. So if you look at the, why is that important to know who might be these people who are in the routine cognitive jobs? Because if we try to calculate the intensity of routine cognitive tasks by various segments of the wage distribution, you can see that routine cognitive is either low pay, like Lithuania or Estonia, or middle pay, like Czechia, Latvia, Romania. But it's never high pay. These are never high pay jobs. So routine cognitive content in Poland among the 20% of the best paid workers is negative, is strongly negative. In all countries, these are negative. So the routine cognitive jobs are either low pay or middle pay. And when we apply the clustering techniques, like the latent class analysis to all the countries in the region, and that clustering identifies two types of routine workers. One type of highly routine workers are people who are, and they constitute like 17% of all total employment in the region is in manufacturing, and these are mainly males. They're usually secondary educated, age 35-44. They perform jobs which are highly routine in cognitive terms, but at the same time highly routine in manual terms, and they're usually medium paid. And there is another group. The another group are people who are working in services. These are services or office jobs, and they constitute 60%. And the other cluster is dominated by females. There are, in most countries, mainly secondary educated, even though in the Baltic states like Estonia, Lithuania, they are also tertiary educated. They are prime age, sometimes a bit older, but usually prime age. They perform jobs which are highly or medium routine cognitive, with very low manual. So that's why I talked about services, trading services, because the other group barely performs any manual jobs, and they are low paid. So there are these two groups. Jointly, they constitute like 33% of total employment, which we identify as highly routine jobs. And in the final part of this presentation, I'm going to focus on the age dimension of these developments. So what's the age dimension? When I mentioned the educational boom, that means that the people who are flocking to the labor market are entering the labor market are better educated. On the other hand, it's kind of intuitive that people who are older might struggle with adoption of technology. So let's focus on the age dimension of these changes. So here, and we actually find that this age dimension is pretty crucial. So there is a difference in the pace of this task content changes between cohorts which were born between 1950 and 1970. And these are the parameters where we estimate just the time trend of task content changes for a particular cohort. So the pace of changes among these cohorts, 1950 to 1970, was relatively low, increasing but slow. And then you can see that the pace of changes among cohorts born in the 70s and in the 80s was very, very high. So that growth of non-routine analytical was largely embedded in people born after the 1970s who entered the labor market in the 90s.
So what is the y-axis here?
It's the parameter from the regression when we regress task content changes against time trend. So that's the slope of the time trend, basically. That's the slope of the time trend, and the for routine cognitive we can see that these are basically flat, so there are not really many differences between cohorts, so negative for all cohorts. So why the routine cognitive were increasing if the trends are negative for all the cohorts is that people who enter have much higher routine cognitive content when they start. So the compositional effects have pushed the routine cognitive up. When we look at the routine manual, we can see that this barely anything changed for people born in the 50s or people born in the 60s a little bit, but then born for people in the 70s and in the 80s, there are strong negative trends when it comes to evolution of manual tasks. So they were declining. So the overall decline, again, largely because of declines among people born after the 1970s, who are moving as a cohort from manual to cognitive jobs and to non-routine cognitive jobs much faster and to much larger extent than the older workers. So if the age dimension is important, so then another question we would like to ask is that what's happening to the routine occupation? If people who are younger experience high increases in non-routine cognitive tasks, then we presume that the routine occupation should, the age structure in routine occupation, highly routine occupation, should evolve differently than the age structure in non-routine occupation. So that's what the question we are asking here. We calculate something which is like RTI measure, so that's relative, so it's the routine task intensity. So we create a scala, a one digit, one dimension variable is like a relative routineness of jobs. So we add two dimensions of routine task and deduct two dimensions of the non-routine tasks. And this is, again, from the Otterndorn 2009 paper. And then we calculate this measure for 1998 for country-specific task structures for about 100 occupations per country, and then regress the change in the average age in the occupation against the RTI measure in 1998, and we control for the share, for the change in the share of particular occupation in total employment. So the significant estimation here, if it's positive and significant, that shows that the occupations which were more intensive in routine tasks in late 90s were aging faster than occupations which were less intensive in routine. And we actually find that this was significant and positive for most of the countries in the region. Estonia doesn't really have it, but all the other countries do have. And the what was the factor behind that faster aging of routine occupation? The factor behind was that the more routine occupations experienced faster declines of the share of young people in this occupation. So the share of people age 15-29 was declining faster in the routine occupations, whereas in many countries the share of workers 55-64 was increasing faster in the routine occupation. So there is, let's call it polarization of younger and older workers by the relative routine intensity of occupation. So older workers tend to cluster in the routine occupations. Younger workers, they, let's say, avoid routine occupations. When we replace the relative routine intensity with non-routine cognitive tasks, in particular occupations we control for change of the share, we see that the occupations which had higher non-routine cognitive content in late 90s, the aging of these occupations was slower. So the average age in this occupation grew less. It was especially visible for analytical, not so much for the personal. And so finally, what's happening to the workers who, what's happening then to workers who are in this routine jobs, if the routine jobs are aging faster than non-routine jobs, and there were some people in routine jobs, so what's happening to them? And so we want to look at the unemployment as well. So in this regression, we calculate the unemployment rate by occupation, which is a number of unemployed people who used to be in that occupation over employment in that occupation and unemployment, so like the labor supply in that occupation. And we find that the higher was the routine intensity in the late 90s, then the higher was the growth of the unemployment rate in that particular occupation. So there is some trade-off. The routine occupations are aging, but also unemployment rate in that occupation increases. And then when we move to the individual level, and we estimate the probability of being unemployed, conditional or sectoral and individual characteristics and firm characteristics, and also this relative routine intensity, we find that that's a significant correlate of the risk of being unemployed, and especially for younger people. So younger people who entered routine occupations are then much more likely to be unemployed, and that's stronger for younger workers than for older workers. And if we compare that effect by two periods of time, we find that in the 2010s, in 2002, 2014, these marginal effects were higher. So it seems that that correlation between risk of unemployment and routine intensity is increasing over time. And it's actually happening in all the countries. So that's for Hungary and Poland here. These are the shapes, these marginal effects by cohort in late 90s. And if we calculate them for 2010s, in Hungary, Hungary is different, but in Hungary, it's just, let's say, collapsing all across the board. So the unemployment risk increased for everyone. In Poland, the routine is the marginal effects for routine intensity also increase as in the other countries. Okay, let me summarize the what we summarize the lessons from that from the task content of jobs exercise on Central and Eastern Europe. We find that from the age dimension, we find the younger cohorts experience stronger changes than older cohorts. Routine intensive occupations are aging faster largely because of declining share of younger workers, and there is higher unemployment risk for people younger or prime age who enter the routine intensive occupations than for workers who haven't entered the routine intensive occupations. So to sum up, the non-routine cognitive tasks have increased in the region and manual tasks have declined, similarly to what was happening in the US or Western Europe. We think that the contribution of labor supply factors as educational boom and workforce upskilling was substantial, maybe even more important than technology. At the same time, the routine cognitive tasks have increased, which is very, very different from what was happening in all Western European countries or in the US. And we think that was because of a very different pattern of structural change in that region in comparison to Western European countries or the US. We find that workers who end up being in highly routine jobs, they are usually middle-skilled and prime age. So that means that if in the future this task content patterns start to resemble the American or German or British one, also in the routine cognitive dimension of these changes, these workers who are prime age, middle-skilled, will be the ones who might suffer from the decline of routine cognitive jobs. And the shift was stronger among younger workers, and probably it's not gonna go like that forever. So as the ICT stock increases and the technology prices decline, the routine jobs will probably decline, as was happening in the Western Europe or American countries. So that moment is probably approaching, and it's not really easy to estimate when this might shift. That's probably something that we are working on now together with Albert. So if you're interested, there are a couple of papers that constitute the background for all of this, so you can find it on our website. And thanks for listening.
Okay, David had a second question. Did you want to add it?
I guess I was probably most struck by your different results for routine cognitive tasks that seems to be different from Western Europe and the United States.
Yes.
So I was wondering whether your impression was that was because of the particular level of development of Eastern Europe, or whether that was connected somehow to the shift from being transition to economies to being market economies over this period.
So these are probably interrelated, but I would say that I would expect a similar shift in any other country that it's still experiencing reallocation of labor from agriculture to non-ag services rather than communist to market one. I think that the structural change is most potent factor here.
So then, actually I had a follow-up question related to this. So you put a lot of kind of weight on this decline of agriculture. A lot of people who study labor market just focus on the non-agricultural labor force. So if you did the same thing, would you still see the pattern of this rise in, if you just looked at the non-agricultural labor market, would you still see this increase in the routine cognitive skills over time? I don't know if you know the answer to that, but I think that would be kind of a thought experiment.
That's easy to check we can just delete the contributions of agriculture and see what are the sums there. In countries that have the highest increase in routine cognitive, like Poland, Romania, I think it would still be there for two reasons. One is the occupational change. So we've also noticed that in like finance or insurance sectors or other services that tend to employ high-skilled workers, we've found that within sectors there was downgrading of workers in terms of the task contents. So a finance and banking worker in 1998 was like highly non-routine, whereas these days more there is a higher number of people who are kind of routine. So I would presume that it would still be there. It would not be that pronounced without agriculture.
Other questions? Okay, keep thinking. I have another question. So you used the ONET data from 2003 and 2014, right?
Yes.
And so you're kind of assuming not only that the task content of occupations in these countries is the same as the U.S., but that the change in the task content over time is the same as the U.S. And that almost automatically is kind of going to influence the growth over time in these different kind of task measures. And so I'm thinking if you didn't make that assumption, if you just stuck to 1 year's ONET variables and just said, so any change would be really due to occupational structure change, would you still see these patterns?
It would be the same, because let me put it this way. We are not entirely happy with the fact that we have to assume that the within occupational change of tasks everywhere was identical as in the US over the same period. But the main reason why we are not happy with that is that the change within occupations 2003-2014 in ONET is very small. So if you see some increase in routine content within occupations, especially the high skill occupations in ONET have that. Like I mentioned pilots. So pilots become much more routine within ONET over time. But these changes are very small. So in the paper, in one of the papers, we actually, here for like clarity, we could decompose the occupational change to between occupation and within occupation.
Right.
So the between occupation is by 10 times higher than within occupation. I mean, its contribution to the change. So again, it's possible that the within occupational change in the middle income countries over the same time was much higher than in the US, because they were catching up in how particular occupations are being performed. But there's just no data. So assuming that Central Eastern Europe 1998 could be like US in the 90s, and trying to approximate the within occupational change by the longer time period in the ONET data, purely speculative. So we decided against it. Yes. So, but I think that in that within occupational change, I think that most of the research which is gonna be done for other countries in the U.S. will struggle with that, because we are not gonna measure. Like, you know, we can measure the task content of manufacturing jobs in China now, but we're not going to measure the content 10 years ago to see how much they change, how much, let's say, routine or non-routine they become. I mean, the train is gone, I'm afraid.
Okay, any other questions, comments? Okay, if not, let me thank Piotr once again for a very stimulating talk.
Thank you.